democracy will prevail.
Margaret Thatcher was determined to put the great back into Britain. But in seeking to change the country, she also provoked intense hostility. Where previous governments had divided national opinion before, this time it was personal. The ire of those who opposed her policies seemed directed at Mrs. Thatcher and her alone. From brutal acts of terrorism to urban riots, civil disobedience, to ministerial dissent, throughout it all, the Prime Minister appeared unmoved. With so much to get done, she had little time to doubt her own convictions. But did her will ever waver? And did events ever influence or change the direction of her government? Each and every British Prime Minister must attend to the issue of Northern Ireland. For Mrs. Thatcher, the gravity of the problem was forcibly brought home by events surrounding her election in 1979. At the start of the election campaign, her right-hand man and unionist sympathiser, Éire Nive, was assassinated by the IRA. His murder was followed 5 months later by that of Lord Mountbatten, and on the same day by that of 18 soldiers at Warren Point, close to the border with the Irish Republic.
I think that Margaret Thatcher was appalled by Warren Point, by the killings in Ireland, by the ferocity of it all. I don't think she ever really brought herself to sympathise about the Irish problem with anybody. She just saw British soldiers being killed, she saw a lot of taxpayers' money being spent, and she just wanted the situation to resolve itself.
On election, Mrs. Thatcher took her first tentative steps into Northern Irish politics with attempts to get all-party talks moving at Stormont.
She was a unionist. She would like Northern Ireland to stay part of the union, but she didn't really sympathise particularly with the unionists, politicians. She was mainly and overwhelmingly concerned with the burden of different kinds on the rest of Britain.
Initial progress was frustrated, and Northern Ireland slipped down the political agenda. But in late 1980 and early 1981, two hunger strikes in the Mays prison in Belfast forced the province back into the spotlight. The hunger strikes were part of a campaign by IRA prisoners inside the jail to regain their special status and be recognised as political prisoners.
Her memoirs do record that while she certainly didn't admire their cause, she did have some regard for the courage of people who were perfectly prepared to starve themselves to death. But it was terrorism by another means, and the whole objective was to force the government to concede. And if Margaret Thatcher had conceded, the government would have been on the run, they would have felt. It wouldn't have stopped terrorism, it would have intensified it.
Bobby Sands MP! Bobby Sands MP! Bobby Sands MP!
The second strike began in March. It was led by the IRA leader in the Mays, Bobby Sands. 2 months later, he died, provoking outrage in the nationalist community.
Within minutes of Bobby Sands dying, crowds of up to 1,000 were gathering all around Republican Belfast. Petrol bombs were hurled at the security forces in large numbers, along with rocks and acid bombs as the barricades went up.
In her memoirs, Mrs. Thatcher refers to this period as the beginning of the time of troubles. The death of Bobby Sands, together with 10 other prisoners, probably recruited more Republicans to the cause of violence and, on a political level, contributed to the strength of Sinn Féin at the expense of the non-violent nationalist party, the SDLP. It certainly led to an upsurge in bombings on the mainland. Mrs. Thatcher, too, became the IRA's top target for assassination.
Look, if you're fighting the IRA, they're going to get you if they can. You've got to be very well protected. And I think Mrs. Thatcher just accepted that that came with the job.
The IRA wasn't the only source of unrest. While petrol bombs were being thrown in Belfast, rioting erupted on the mainland, beginning in Brixton, South London, in April 1981. The violence and disorder were later said to be on a scale not previously seen in this century in Britain.
Several of the rioters last night, like this one, have been white, and it's clear that the feelings are directed not against whites as such, but against the police.
Home Secretary William Whitelaw immediately commissioned a senior judge, Lord Scarman, to report on the riots, their cause, and how further rioting might be prevented.
Community relations officers in these areas have been working very hard to establish better relations, and it seemed that was the right way of going, in the hope that it would succeed.
The inquiry was widened in July when other riots occurred in Southall, West London, Toxteth in Liverpool, and Moss Side in Manchester.
Let me tell you, if anybody attack you, police will caught the man within 24 hours. But anybody if he's attacked any action, even six months, they can't afford to arrest that man.
Well, I don't accept that. And, this is an allegation that's made not only from that area, from other parts of London, and we refute it.
The opposition Labour Party were quick to lay blame for the riots at the door of Margaret Thatcher's economic policies.
The nature of the economic crisis inflicted on many parts of Britain and many parts of the major cities gave a sort of excuse to elements amongst disaffected youth to resort to violence. That doesn't offer any justification for what occurred. There isn't any. But there are reasons.
Mrs. Thatcher was having none of it. Unemployment could never explain or excuse the riots. The government's fiscal policy was not indicted, and neither would it change. Instead, the police would in future be equipped with better riot control equipment.
These were not economic riots. They were social unrest. They were racial antagonisms. There were all kinds of worries of a depressed community, but depression going far wider than anything which was purely economic.
Attempts to make progress in Ireland continued. In late 1981, Jim Prior became Northern Ireland Secretary. Prior proposed a form of rolling devolution for the province, whereby a local assembly might evolve from small beginnings into a forum of genuinely devolved power sharing.
The unionists were divided. Paisley wanted devolution because Paisley wanted to be in power in Northern Ireland. But a lot of the unionists, including Enoch Powell, who had a considerable influence over Margaret Thatcher, didn't want devolution. They wanted integration. They wanted the difference between Northern Ireland and the rest of us in the UK to be abolished, as it were, so that Northern Ireland was just the same as Worcestershire or Lancashire.
The violence and killings continued both in Northern Ireland and on the mainland. On the 20th of July 1982, IRA terrorists struck in London, first in Hyde Park, killing two, and later in Regent's Park, killing six.
What was the scene, as you could see, when you got near where the explosion had happened?
Carnage. Okay. Carnage, sheer carnage. Terrible, terrible.
Mrs. Thatcher visited the wounded the following day.
They're all marvellously brave, and in spite of their injuries, wonderfully cheerful. They really are an example to us. And the total faith between them and the nursing staff and doctors is wonderful. And the nursing staff, they told me they worked on and on and on until everything they could do had been done. Our anger at those who did this, of course, is total. They're just barbaric and vicious, the people who did this. But they mustn't win.
The atrocities did not derail the work of government. And so, as planned on the 23rd of July, the Northern Ireland Act, which established the rules for a devolved assembly, became law.
Gradually, under Jim Prior, then under me and so on, we got, of course with the Prime Minister's consent, a negotiation going with the Irish Republic. She was keen on that because she wanted the Irish police, the Gardaí, and the Irish Army to help on the military, on the security side. And she was content to give the Irish a certain amount, not too much, not joint rule, but a certain amount of leeway in return for that cooperation. That was the bargain as she saw it.
Terrorism and riots presented problems for the government and for the police. But an altogether different challenge to authority came from a group of women and their supporters who set up camp outside Greenham Common Air Base in Berkshire. It became a very powerful symbol of dissent.
The peace protesters came from all over the country.
The women's peace camp had been established in 1981 in protest against NATO's decision to site cruise missiles at Greenham Common, a decision endorsed by Mrs. Thatcher. The missiles finally arrived at Greenham in November 1983.
The arrival of cruise missiles on British soil was a carefully thought out process. It was not so much supporting the Americans, it was combating world communism and saying to the Russians, not on our backyard. Now, the Greenham Common ladies were part of a left-wing group. They were feminists, they were people who wanted to change the whole system. They were so much not what Margaret Thatcher believed in or respected. And I think she just waited until they kind of ran out of puff.
Mrs. Thatcher was in no doubt the protest she once described as an increasingly strident unilateralist campaign was of little worth or influence. It was the West's willingness to deploy the missiles that altered the course of negotiation with the Soviet Union, not the actions of the women's peace camp. She was unimpressed.
It worked, of course, because Gorbachev came in 1985. And 4 years later, 1989, the Berlin Wall came down. The whole Soviet system collapsed. And one reason why it collapsed was because the Soviet leaders realized that they could not win.
Protest of the violent kind continued with IRA attacks on the mainland, including in October 1984, the bombing of the Grand Hotel in Brighton.
Listen, Harvey, just one question before we go. Was there anyone with you in that room?
No, nobody at all.
Nobody at all in that room?
If the IRA had failed in its attempt to assassinate Mrs. Thatcher, it also failed to derail the conference itself. As scheduled, the Prime Minister addressed delegates later that same day.
The fact that we are gathered here now, shocked, but composed and determined, is a sign not only that this attack has failed, but that all attempts to destroy democracy by terrorism will fail.
The response of the Brighton bomb was totally typical, whereas there were many at the time milling around saying, of course, this conference must be abandoned, we cannot go on. She was of entirely the opposite opinion. We must go on. We must show that terrorism won't win. And she was the one who decided right from the time that the masonry was still falling, that they would meet, that we would meet once again that morning to continue with the business of the conference and with the business of government, that the terrorist would not win.
They cheered and stamped their feet for more than 7.5 minutes.
Mrs. Thatcher would later write, "I was not going to appear to be bombed to the negotiating table." Instead, she toughened her position with regard to the ongoing talks with the Republic and parties in the province. But she was far from obsessed by Northern Ireland.
Margaret Thatcher didn't keep her attention all the time on Ireland. She wasn't like John Major or Tony Blair, who really had to live with it day by day. She came back to it at intervals. And it was always slightly difficult because she always started from the beginning. She always started as if nothing had happened until that moment when we were talking. And so you had to go through the whole issue with her again. She was quite attracted by the idea of repartitioning, by drawing the line in a different place. One had to explain over and over again that actually the communities were so mixed up, for example, in Belfast, that there was no line which was neat and tidy. So you had to move through the argument the whole time. And then there was the question about what we were prepared to give the Irish Republic in return for them accepting the crucial point that the future of Northern Ireland should be decided by the people of Northern Ireland and not by anybody else. That was the essential bargain. And the Prime Minister moved towards it. And by the time I left, the bargain wasn't concluded, but it was in sight.
The IRA would continue its campaign of violence. So too, rioting would return to Britain's inner cities. In September 1985, riots broke out in Handsworth in Birmingham and again in Brixton, South London. Both had been triggered by police raids, the one in Brixton following the accidental police shooting of a black woman, Cherry Gross. A month later, there was a similar incident at the Broadwater Farm Estate in Tottenham. Four policemen raided a flat. They burst through the door, and Cynthia Jarrett, who lived there, died of heart failure. In the trouble that followed, shots were fired at the police for the first time in a riot on the British mainland, and one officer was seriously injured. Shortly afterwards, PC Keith Blakelock was stabbed in the neck while trying to protect firefighters. He later died from his injuries.
In my view, the police made a serious miscalculation when they decided to search the dead woman's home for stolen property, and having found none, the poor woman having died, you can imagine what happened.
I think that she always had a degree of impatience with any kind of civil disorder. I don't think she had any sympathy for what she called the bleeding hearts, who said, we don't like this vision of policemen sort of attacking demonstrators. For her, you know, the demonstrators had it coming to them, I think.
I think that there were people there who were out to cause trouble. And of course, if you cause trouble, there will be somebody, especially in the areas in which they occurred, where it'll escalate a bit. And these were people who are professional agitators. And they always surface when Tory governments are in power.
Well, I'm just taking an assessment of it, and it's quite clear that there's been some outrageous behaviour here. There's been a riot, and the police have contained it, and they seem to have done it rather well.
You're pleased with your men's actions so far this evening?
Well, when you get men standing up against petrol bombs with no equipment here to repel it, I think you must put this down as the most restrained police force in the world.
Reported as the worst rioting seen in mainland Britain, commentators seized on the event as indicative of a government and a society that had turned its back on the deep-seated social deprivation in its midst.
Alienated youth, frustrated youth, youth feeling that it didn't have any voice that was going to be noticed, felt that it had a right to resort to violence. It didn't. But that was the feeling. And then, of course, after the first brick is thrown, the first petrol bomb is thrown, events look after themselves.
For Mrs. Thatcher, nothing could justify the violence or the attacks on the police. But while she condemned the rioting, and while her priority in office would remain the economy, during Mrs. Thatcher's second and third terms, the government did start to address social policy. The Prime Minister's advisers even dubbed the policy social Thatcherism.
She was very robust about anything connected with disorder, whether it was in the miners' strike, most famously, or in the city riots. She was perfectly prepared to look at the causes, but she was not prepared to tolerate outbreaks of violence.
1985 also saw further moves on Northern Ireland. Given all that had gone before, it was a tribute to Margaret Thatcher that she was still determined to find a solution to the Troubles. After various initiatives and lots of diplomatic activity between London and Dublin, by November they were ready to sign the Anglo-Irish Agreement. For the first time, it allowed the Dublin government to have a say in affairs north of the border, although without power over decisions.
We protest most vehemently that you are negotiating the affairs and future of Northern Ireland with a foreign government which not only claims our territory, but harbours the murderers of our people.
Unionist MPs first threatened and later resigned in protest at a treaty they simply didn't trust.
Unionists would cease cooperation with government ministers and resign their seats unless a summit referendum was held.
Should Parliament proceed to approve this deal without first consulting the people of Northern Ireland, we will invite all Unionist members of the House of Commons to resign their seats forthwith.
Margaret Thatcher may not have succeeded in Northern Ireland, but she did start the process of involving the Republic, setting the model for later negotiations, culminating with the Good Friday Agreement.
I think the Anglo-Irish Agreement was the original bedrock of the whole peace process, and I think, to be fair, it was owed as much to civil servants on both sides as it was to politicians. And she allowed it to happen. I don't think she was a great enthusiast for it. And she went along with it, as it were, and all credit for her doing that.
Where terrorism, riots and peaceful protest had seemingly left the Iron Lady unmoved, it was events within her own cabinet shortly after that did most to disturb Mrs. Thatcher's composure, and all over a small company called Westland.
The Ministry of Defence still hopes that the shareholders will reject the deal, something Westland's management will fight against. But some politicians feel it's the thin end of the wedge, which would end up with Westland as an assembly operation for a vast American company.
Westland had been highly successful in the past, but the company had fallen on hard times. It needed help, and the only solution was a tie-up with another bigger company. Leon Britton, now in charge at the DTI, thought the US company Sikorsky was the answer. Defence Secretary Michael Heseltine wanted a European solution and had tried to secure a deal involving Italy, France, Germany and the UK.
The argument developed inside government about really who should make our helicopters. And Michael Heseltine was very keen on what one might call the European solution and Leon Britton more on the American type solution. The Prime Minister certainly on general grounds favoured the American type solution. But the thing got out of hand. And she mishandled it. And for the first time, really, in her premiership, her grip of government wavered.
The row between Leon Britton and Michael Heseltine continued into the new year. At Westland itself, the board and workforce were minded to accept the American offer, but they were still subject to intense lobbying by Heseltine's European consortium.
The Europeans' plans for helicopters are not at all well defined. But should they come through, potentially the European route would offer a better prospect in the long term for Westland. It's got to balance all those factors. My own feeling is they will probably come down on the side of the European offer in the end.
Michael Heseltine was by now convinced there was a dirty tricks campaign against him. There was a showdown at the cabinet meeting on the 9th of January. Heseltine found himself isolated and is said to have erupted. Then, after collecting his papers, he walked out of the cabinet.
The Conservative chairman, Norman Tebbit, denied that Mr. Heseltine had stormed out of the cabinet.
Michael didn't storm out, you know, and I think that's going over the top. Michael did what he did, I think, with very great regret, and I think we were all surprised, but he said that he couldn't accept the procedure. He accepted the decisions and entirely supported them, but he couldn't accept the procedure, and I think that was sad, in my view.
Once he saw that the machinery of government, as he perceived it, was ranged against him, he was not going to get, in his view, a fair crack of the argument. Then he obviously began to think, I'm not going to put up with this. How can I show that best? By walking out. And the theatrical side of him asserted itself, and he walked out.
But Heseltine's resignation wasn't the end of the story. He launched a scathing attack on Mrs. Thatcher during his personal statement to the House of Commons, and the war of words continued for several weeks. It was all complicated by a row over the leak of a letter from the Solicitor General that had been sent earlier on in the saga to Michael Heseltine.
What is a leak? A leak is an unauthorised disclosure of information. Who can authorise disclosures of information? Ministers. Who authorised the disclosure of information in this case? A minister, Leon Britton. So why was it a leak? And the answer is, it was only a leak because it was a piece of discourtesy. He didn't consult the other ministers involved. It wasn't a government leaking against the opposition. It was a government fighting among itself.
Eventually, Leon Britton was forced to quit. He handed in his resignation on the 24th of January.
Can I ask you why you decided to resign at this point in the proceedings?
I don't think I wish to give an interview just at the moment. Thank you very much.
He'd lost support, I think, in his own party. But it was a harbinger of doom that eventually overtook Margaret Thatcher, and at the base of it was the big internal argument within the government about Europe, between the Eurosceptics and the Europhiles, Montagues and Capulets.
Westland was finally taken over by the American company Sikorsky, and Michael Heseltine moved to the Tory backbenches. But the affair had been damaging to the party and left Mrs. Thatcher thinking hard about her own position.
Up to then, she had been able to rely on collective cabinet responsibility. And when Michael Heseltine stormed out because she had ordered him, basically, to shut up, and he felt it was such a point of principle that he couldn't support this, walked out of the cabinet, I think she was just utterly bewildered that anybody would behave like that, because her code of government and ministerial responsibility was meant that if Michael didn't agree with it, then Michael should have stayed and joined with the rest of us in carrying forward the cabinet's decision. But that shows, of course, that over her time in government, how things were beginning to change, that people got to the stage where they felt that she was beginning to act in an autocratic manner.
Mrs. Thatcher had faced many a challenge to her policies and to her person, so it was extraordinary that in her second term, the event that almost toppled her from power was a row over a small manufacturing company. From this point, the Thatcher cabinet was split between a generally sceptical group and a small number loyal to the PM. Her policies would not necessarily be changed, but she had been dealt a severe blow.
I hoped that the lesson of Westland would be that she would actually be a bit more conscious of cabinet, a bit more receptive to advice, provided it was loyally intended, and you know, a bit more open in her ways. But she didn't, really. She went back to that rather autocratic way of taking decisions in cabinet, which in the end built up the opposition which destroyed her.
In the next programme, how Mrs. Thatcher took on the unions and won.
You can order Margaret Thatcher a tribute in words and pictures for the special half-price fee of £10. Call Telegraph Books on 0870 155 7222 or order online at www.books.telegraph.co.uk.